Good morning, MCC.
Good morning.
Welcome to Metropolitan Community Church of Baton Rouge. It's a great day to worship. Looks like we got aces and spaces here, but I think probably some more folks will come in as we go along. So if you would stand as you are able for our opening song.
We cannot see. He will make a way. Will you pray with me this morning? God, we just thank you so much for bringing each and every one of us here today. And God, we know that you can truly make a way, that anything can be done. God, we ask today that you fill us with that strength. God, that you fill us with that power, that you fill us with that energy. That God, you let us know that as the mother and father of all of us, that God, you can make a way for us to do anything that you would have us to do. So God, as we go forth from this place today, as we worship you today, just help us to know that those words are true above all else. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to MCC of Baton Rouge. Will you tell somebody around you that they're in the right place today?
We're in the right place today.
This morning's scripture readings are from Psalms and Philippians. The first reading is from the book of Psalms, chapter 46, verses 1 through 3. God is our refuge and strength, and ever-present help in trouble. Therefore, we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. The second reading is from Philippians chapter 4, verses 4 through 6. Rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. Let your gentleness be evident to all. The Lord is near. Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation, by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Hear what the Spirit says today.
Good morning to you all. The fall of 1995, I walked through the doors of MCC over at Chime Street. I didn't want to hear preaching and I didn't want to hear music. I wanted to know, do you love me, God? And when I walked through the doors, I heard it. And I have held on to it since then. I heard this song and I just had to share it with you, because it's about God's love, not just for in here, but it's God's love for you to take out there where it really works.
Stay. Well, since you all know that I'm a teacher, and I always start with a story about my kids, here's another story about the day in the life of a teacher. I'm currently tutoring a student of mine at the library after school each day. And when I met him this past Tuesday, I was running late as usual, and he was waiting for me on the curb outside of the library. He was so eager to start working that he practically climbed inside my car when I leaned in to get the work out of my trunk. We went inside and he led me to the secret homework spot, which is really just the children's section in the library. As we began working on solving word problems, I looked over and noticed this little girl sitting not more than 5 feet from me. I don't know how long she'd been there because I didn't notice her before, or how my student, who is extremely ADHD, hadn't noticed her before I did. I don't know how long she'd been there, but she leaned in close to where we were working and she said, "I'm supposed to be in fifth grade. My mom held me back because I have ADHD." My student looked at her and I gave her the typical teacher response when you don't really know what to say. "Oh." She continued to move in closer till she was literally sitting inches from my student and I. She leaned over again to my student who was furiously working but making careless mistakes and she said, "Think. I always work better when I think." My student, without even looking up, said, "I can't think slow, I only think fast." She looked at him and she said, "Try going slow, now keep working." So besides completely stealing my teaching thunder, she had made a good point. How can you think when you move at such a fast pace? So how many of you are perpetually late? I'm sure you noticed I arrive late for church almost every Sunday. In fact, I got up at 9 today, and we didn't even leave the house till after 10. Even when I set my alarm for 6 a.m. every morning, I can't seem to crawl out of bed until 6:30, and that always puts me behind. I've tried setting my alarm clock earlier. I move my clock so they're all 5 minutes ahead of the actual time. My mom always used to tell me when I was little that when I move my clocks ahead, I won't be late. In my case, I compensate for the 5 minutes I set my clock ahead early by going 5 minutes slower. I see some people do that too. So even when we're running perpetually late, like my student waiting for me eagerly at the curb before tutoring, God is always waiting for us when we're late. We must only remember to call on him. So how hard is this to remember, though? It seems so easy to say pray every night or pray every morning, and we can get in the habit of doing these things. But when we're in the habit of doing these things, are we really praying like we should? Are we really being mindful of God like we should? The Bible speaks of living a life of prayer. And while this is extremely important, I think it's more important that we're mindful of God in our everyday lives. We must take time to slow down, breathe, acknowledge God, and like the student said, keep working. I've struggled with this lately. Slowing down isn't what I'm good at. Even though I run late, I do actually have an amazing ability to get up at 6:30, be dressed and ready to leave by 6:40. Now, what happens between 6:40 and when I arrive at school at 7:20, I never really understand. But lateness aside, I have to remember God when I'm rushing. I have to slow down and greet God. God is like that little girl sitting 5 feet from me and my student. God is always waiting there to say, "Slow down, think, remember, I'm with you." Psalm 46 said, "God is our refuge and strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble." This year has come with many struggles for us. Personally, I'm short on time, energy. I haven't been able to do the things that I love. And I know some of you have lost loved ones or maybe jobs. When we feel like we're just trying to stay afloat, when we are, as a teacher friend of mine likes to say, arranging the deck chairs on the Titanic, remember that God is ever present. When I'm taking what teachers call a walking lunch, meaning I'm eating as I'm walking, God is with me saying, "Slow down, breathe, think of me." Being with me, however, doesn't let me off the hook. I can know that God is with me, but if I don't call on him, I'm not taking the initiative. God is an ever-present help in time of trouble, but I must let him into my life. I must pray to him or even just take time to think of him. God spends plenty of time thinking of me and thinking of us. As Psalm said, therefore we will not fear, though the earth give way and the mountains fall into the heart of the sea, though its waters roar and foam and the mountains quake with their surging. When we call to God, we have nothing to fear. God can tear down our mountains and calm our roaring waters. God will help me to stop rearranging those deck chairs and begin being constructive. God can help you with what you're struggling with at this moment. But where do we find the time in our busy schedules to pray, to call for God? Now, I'm not suggesting a life that's consumed with prayer. Many churches these days are brandishing that slogan, a prayer-conditioned church. But what does this really mean? Does it mean that we're always praying? Does it mean that we're praying each day? In my opinion, a prayer-conditioned life is one that's mindful of God. We can't go through this world alone. We need God, and we need to know that God supports us and sustains us. And we remember this through calling on God, whether it's with prayer, meditation, or simply thinking of Him and the sacrifice He made for us as we go throughout that day. When I was little, I learned the 23rd Psalm in my Sunday school class. It was a rite of passage to learn the 23rd Psalm, but as I've grown older, I've used the Psalm to help me in situations where I'm very, very stressed. The 23rd Psalm says, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters, and He restores my soul." God is the one who's walking with us. He has helped us to get where we are today, and God is sitting by our sides, bringing us to those green pastures and by those still waters and restoring our souls. But unless we think of God, unless we thank God, we may be blind to all that the Lord has accomplished in our lives and through us. In Philippians we hear, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God, and the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Right here, we're hearing in Paul's letter to the Philippians that when we're anxious about anything, we must call on God. He's saying to us, don't go it alone. Don't try to fight your battles without first telling God. When I was younger, I had to let my parents know where I was going. I had to tell them what I was doing. I had to call and check in on them. We are all the sons and the daughters of God. Just like I had to check in with my parents, we have to check in with our Father in heaven. Send God a text message. Tell Him where you'll be and what you'll be doing. God put us on this earth, but He expects us to help Him follow up. When we call to God, when we're really taking that time to let God in, when we find a peace that helps us to slow down, to take time and think, when we find that peace that's enough to help us sit down during lunch and not be so anxious. God says that we have nothing to fear. He says that we must rejoice in Him always. The 23rd Psalm says that God leads us beside still waters and restores our souls. Do you remember what comes next? "Nay, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I fear no evil, for You are with me." But who is with me? You are with me. God is with me. Jesus is with me. My brothers and sisters in Christ are with me. We have a responsibility to God to help each other. The ultimate responsibility is to guide our brothers and our sisters to call out to God in these times of trouble. Yes, God walks with us and talks to us. But if I never turn around and say, "Oh, hey, God, what good is God doing if He's just following behind me?" But really now, what time? As you can see, what time? The biggest gift that I've earned from being a teacher is the gift of a strong bladder. I hardly ever go to the bathroom during the day because I never have time. If I can eat my lunch standing up or walking across the school grounds, And if I never have time to go to the bathroom, when do I have the time to call God up and check in? I want you to think right now, what's your daily ritual? You know we all have one, so what do you do every day? Every day I call my dad for exactly 7 minutes on the drive to my house, from my house to school. Exactly 7 minutes, I've timed it. Now, I'm not suggesting that I give up my 7 minutes or that you should give up your scheduled activities, but I will not lose any time with my dad if I take just a few minutes or a few seconds to pause as I pull out of my driveway and call God first. I've been very busy and overwhelmed this year, and many things in my life have slipped. I'm sure many in your lives have too. I haven't gone to the gym as much. I don't practice my instruments as much. I spend much more time sleeping than I ever did reading, and I barely have time to go for walks in the evening. When I think of all those things that I have to do every day, I don't know where God fits into all of that, but I know he does, because God is an ever-present and patient God. Being busy is not a good enough excuse to not take a few minutes for God each day. The creator of the universe took more than just a few minutes when he carefully made you. We owe him those few minutes. Corrie ten Boom said, "A man is powerful on his knees." I know getting to your knees might be physically challenging for some, but why can't we be metaphorically on our knees in praise? When I'm in my car and taking my moment's pause to say hello to God, I'm on my knees. When I'm helping a sister or a brother call God, I'm on my knees. Right now, in this place, I'm on my knees and calling to God. Even though I can stand here and we can all come here to this place, we must leave here on our knees, acknowledging the greatness and the glory that is our ever-present God. Rejoice in the Lord always. God is our refuge and our strength, an ever-present help in times of trouble. God is all these things and so much more. A life in reverence is a life on our knees. I read a poem this week, and it's a short one. It's called Until, and it's by the 14th century poet Hafez. He said, "I think we are frightened every moment of our lives until we know him." How deep is that? And I love the shape of it too. I think we are frightened every moment of our lives until we know him. When I read this poem, I thought about how many people don't know God. Or even more than that, how many people know God but don't talk to God? How many people who find that returning God's phone call is not a high priority? It's not an item on their to-do list every day. How can we expect God to fix our problems if we don't tell him that we have any? When I'm frustrated and overwhelmed, when I feel like I've done everything right, only for someone else to come and mess it all up, do we know how to do this? We know this story? I can rant and I can rave, but if I don't tell God that I'm mad, how am I supposed to expect him to know? How can God calm me down if I don't tell him? Let him come into my life and put his hands on me and answer my prayers or my questions? How can he calm me down if he doesn't know that I'm mad? This is when I don't know God, when I'm a stranger to God, when God is a stranger to me. I think we are frightened every moment of our lives until we know him. Don't be frightened. Know that when the going gets tough, the tough get God. Be the tough one, get God. This past week, the 11th, was National Coming Out Day. This is a very special time in the life of the LGBTQ and ally community, because this is the time when we come together to tell our community our story, and we help others to find their own peace with their identity and come out. As I saw videos posted on the It Gets Better YouTube page, and saw the notices that talked about the It Gets Better Google Hangout online, and received the notifications from my undergraduate college about National Coming Out Day festivities, I was reminded again of just how special this church is and this community is to me. This church has been my saving grace in Louisiana. It has helped me stay connected to my faith and to God when I'm rushing through my day and I'm so stressed out that I can't sleep at night. But when I reflect on my experience at this church and on the relationships I've made, I remember that there are still so many people who do not know we're here. We could have a church community that is so much bigger if all those who we know that are closeted or who are living openly know that we have an empty chair for them. We could have a worship attendance that's standing room only. We have to find these people, and we have to bring them to our community or tell them to think of God. So many people in our community are needlessly bullied. There's an incredibly high suicide rate among LGBTQ youth. We need to remind these individuals especially that God loves them and that God's thinking of them, and that every person in this world has been carefully created and designed according to his plan. We have to remember to thank him and to think of him and all those sacrifices that he's made for us. I want you to remember your coming out story. I want you to think about who the most influential person was in your story. For me, it was God. I spent so much time talking to God, trying to convince him to change his mind. Every day since then, I've thanked God for my life and for my blessings, and I'm so much happier today than I ever was before I tried to convince God to change his mind. When we're struggling, when we're rushing through life, we have to think of God and remember that he's carefully made us all according to his image and his plan. Not our image and our plans, but his image and his plans. The Bible says in Genesis that God created human beings in his own image. Male and female, he created them. When you remember this and you remember the 23rd Psalm, know that God leads you beside those still waters and restores your soul. Even when we don't realize that our cup is overflowing or that our mountains are quaking, God is helping us on our paths. We have to thank him. We have to call him up and say, hey, God, thanks. But really, with what time? So how do we make time? Pencil God into your schedule. Make a phone date with God and speak to him. Speak to him like a friend, like a family member. Speak to him like a parent. Above all, take time and think. There's no point in going it alone when God has been there. Talk to God. This November is our presidential election. Now, while I hate to talk about politics in general, and especially hate to talk about politics in church, we can't deny that this November will be a very stressful month. If we've been watching the debates, or if we've heard about the debates, I for one can say that I'm frightened. I would like to say that I have faith in the American people to choose the candidate that I want. I'm not gonna name drop, but his name rhymes with Barack Obama. But I can say that this year I'm completely confident in the American public. I think both candidates have valid points, but this year I'm once again certain that I never want to run for presidential office. As I was reading those minute-by-minute status updates on Facebook, I kept hearing, God is our refuge and strength. I know that no matter how scary the debates have gotten, and they've gotten scary, the earth will give way and the mountains will fall into the sea. God will break the barriers and bring goodness and mercy to his people. And I'm sure that this election season, God is hearing many, many prayers. And while we can't expect God to swing the election, even though I wish he could, I know that though those waters may roar and foam, God controls it all. And when I call to him with my fears, God will always answer me. So this week I challenge you to seek your refuge and your strength in God. I want you to use him as your ever-present help in times of trouble. You don't have to pray all the time, but spend some time on your actual or your metaphorical knees. Call on God when you're stressed. Let him help you find peace. Look at your schedule and pencil God in. Find a time each day when you can call to God. I'm not going to tell you how long to speak to God for. That's your choice. But you must at least think of him, even if it's fleetingly. I challenge you to find your green pastures and your still waters and allow your mountains to fall into the sea. Most of all, think and slow down. As a student at the library said, you always work better when you think and slow down. Let us pray. God, help me to take time and think. Help me to remember you and your promise to me when I'm stressed. This week, as I spend time praying or meditating, help me to find the power in my words and the power that I find in you when I'm on my knees in prayer. God, take away my fear and fill my life with your word and your strength. Always in your name I pray. Amen.
Becky's comments about politics reminded me of a conversation that we had last night on the way home in the car after our, in a, 2 hours after the football game, we were still in a traffic jam. So let's just put it that way. So we have time for profound conversation in our car then that way. So, and Rick saw a campaign billboard or something and said, well, you know, it may not all go the way that we would like for it to, and Becky's candidate may not win like we would like, but you know, I didn't make any comment on that. But you know, I'm not doing political commentary. But you know that there are lots of other races that are still important. There are lots of other things that are still important. So we need to make sure we get out and vote, you know, and that other people get out and vote, because our votes do make a difference. Now, why do I tell you that? Well, the same thing is true of what we give to church and what we do for church. You know, we may not have a fortune to give and pay off the mortgage, or we may not have a fortune to give to completely erase the little deficit we've got right now, but we do have something to give, and we have it to give because God has blessed us with that. So I invite you now to join in supporting God's ministry, and will you pray with me to bless this offering? God, we just thank you so much for the gifts that you have given us. God, we apologize for the times when we don't take the time to say thanks. And God, for the times that we don't take the time to check in with you. But God, we ask now that you will bless this offering, bless each and every hand that provides it. God, we just thank you so much for providing us with the ability to give of our finances and our time and our talents. And God, we ask that you bless this and help our leaders to spread this just as far as it can to serve you and our community and you around the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, very, very long time ago, Jesus called his friends and his disciples into the back room. He knew that he was going to be betrayed, and he told them that they needed to remember him. They need to do all these things in remembrance of him, to take time and to think of him. He held up the bread and he broke it and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Every time that you do this, think of me. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup filled with the fruit of the vine. He said, "This is my blood shed for you. Every time that you drink of this, do it in remembrance of me." At MCC, everybody is welcome at the table. You don't have to be a member of this church or any church to come to this table and receive these gifts in Jesus' name. At MCCBR, we do it by intinction. We're going to have the little wafers, dip them in the drink, and put them either in your hands or on your tongue. The only thing we ask is that you come as the ushers direct you. May the acolytes and servers please come.
Let us pray. Dear God, thank you for this time of worship. Yes. Thank you for this place to gather and be with our friends and our family,
yes,
our chosen or our biological,
yes,
and to let us be here with you in your presence,
yes,
to take this time today to think of you and all that you've done for us in our lives.
Yes.
Help us as we leave from this place to find other people,
yes,
to bring back with us, to show us this place that means so much.
Yes.
Help us to take time in our lives this week to think of you, to find a place in our schedule to call on you, God, and to know that even when we are stressed and we are looking for some help and some guidance, that we can always call on you.
Yes.
God, help us this day to take any food that we eat, that we receive, and to let it fill us and sustain us,
yes,
and help our bodies to become instruments for you, God.
Amen.
Yes. Every day we live for you,
yes,
always in your name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.